Harry, we're here because we're worried.
You got the tide brought in.
Says the man without sunglasses. Suddenly, his expression changes and he tilts his head. Yep, my partner, from the Whirling in Rags, no longer wearing his blonde wig.
Harry, you're bleeding all over the place. You're half dead.
Thanks. Redrick says, whatever this is, it is completely unimportant compared to what you've just seen. Okay, so the three people, where's Lillian? Visual Calculus says, this is the man with sunglasses from the Whirling in Rags, but where are his sunglasses? Wait, you're the man with sunglasses.
That's right. And you're bleeding.
No one else seems bothered by the bleeding.
Bothered by it? Harry, you look like you need a fucking organ transplant. Fuck it. Let's not get into that.
Forget all about this. There's a giant...
We're not forgetting about anything. Look at you.
He points at you with both hands. Who are you people?
Hello, I'm Trent Heidelstam. I believe we've met on several occasions.
Is that the guy who was standing in front of the Feld building?
I'm your goddamn partner, Jean Vicmar, and this is your special task force, or what's left of it.
He says, gesturing toward his companions.
Special Consultant Trent Heidelstam, Patrol Officer Judith Minow.
Okay, so it was these people, not the mercenaries. Notice it was the same, maybe to throw us off. Two men and a woman.
Hi.
We have come to scrape what's left of you off the pavement.
Lieutenant Kim Kisoragi, Precinct 57. We've just come from the island where our investigation led us.
He points to the sea for it. Redrick says, the scene is making even him feel as though he has to justify your actions.
We might need your help with something later.
He adds, suddenly regaining his confidence. Authority says, as if he's recalled that he's in fact a decorated police lieutenant and not a naughty boy.
But this is clearly a departmental matter, so I'm going to leave you to discuss it among yourselves.
Way to feed me to the wolves.
It's good to meet you, Lieutenant Kitsuragi.
She says warmly, flashing Kim the tiniest of smiles. Composure says, letting the lieutenant know he shouldn't feel embarrassed over the bleep storm that's about to befall you. What is this about?
Harry, we want to help you. Trent, I believe this is where you come in.
I don't quite know what I'm doing here. I was asked to participate as an expert. I think I need to manage your expectations a little. I'm at best an enthusiast in cognitive science.
He takes a step back.
My background is in something else entirely. I engage in neurology on a merely theoretical level. In fact, I should probably get going.
No, Trent, it's too late. You're part of this shit now. What have you got to say for yourself, shit kid?
He turns to you. Authority says, what does he have to say for himself? He left you to catch the bullets. Conceptualization says, bleep kid, what an interesting moniker. How did you know I was here? The cafeteria manager you scoot over told us where you went. That's dramatic. I saved this establishment and still he betrays me? Strange. He didn't mention that. In fact, the establishment didn't look saved at all. There's a giant arrow graffito in front of the building. It was on fire. Yeah, I lit it on fire. It was a poetic gesture. I knew it. Didn't I tell you, Trant? I told you it was our bleep kid. The line is from Lou Jardin's Mirova 82, isn't it? About girl-child communism, the titular returning character, the ghostly apparition of... He looks around, and noticing the impatience of his companions, stops himself. Good choice, Harry. Encyclopedia says he is correct. It was the Cerise poet La Giotune who in the 50s of the last century composed a... Don't encourage him, Trant, Jean says. Okay. What's a bleep kid? You. That's you. Rhetoric says, despite all that you've done, the deserter, the phasmid, the case, despite all that I've done? No, because of all that you've done. You aren't the man with sunglasses at all. You're not even blonde. Guilty as charged. He exchanged a look with the special consultant. I heard you lost your mind and your memory. I wanted to see if it was true. And it was. Good work, Harry. You're insane now. There's one less person for me, and everyone else, to rely on. Rhetoric says he was too sarcastic for you to realize who he was. Actually, I suspected something was off. Did you? He adjusts his tie. Or did you literally not recognize my face? We've been partners for how long, Harry? Don't answer that. You don't remember. So Trant Hiddlestam turns out to be Special Consultant Trant Hiddlestam. Yes. I'm Trant. I never said I wasn't Trant. Right, it was him in front of the Feld building. So what was up with the kid then? Mikhail, I think. Mikhail's my son. Oh yeah, what was up with all the interesting history? Spying on me? No, I was just interested in the Feld building and the Martinez beachhead. And Mikhail wanted to see Martinez. It was a coincidence. So what are you special consulting here? What indeed? He looks at the dilapidated shacks, then you. I was asked to share my take on some of the more obscure theories developed in Königstein in the 30s, like partial psychotraumatic amnesia, group personality theory. Jean says, he's here to see if you're insane. He's smart. Let's move on. You never told me you're not the horse-faced woman? Lieutenant, she says with a heavy sigh, my name is not horse-faced woman. It's Judith Minot. I was assigned to your unit 2 months ago. I thought we were friends. We're still friends. I just have a stupid head. Okay. Because you're my commanding officer, I really want to respect you. I want us to have a normal relationship. That will never happen, Jude, Jean says. He's the rudest man on Earth. He's the reason why the rest of us have to take sensitivity training, and I hate sensitivity training. You mentioned a task force? Yes, Major Crimes Unit under Lieutenant Dubois and Vic Mayer. Ring any bells? Refresh my memory. Who else is in this? Refresh your memory? It's a goddamn Major Crimes Unit. There's you, me, Jude, Trant Hiddlestam, and Guillaume Bevy. He stares at you. Trant says, I'm technically just a civilian advisor. Jean says, screw you, you're part of this bleep show. Who's Guillaume Bevy? Oh, that's an interesting story, actually. He's not smiling. Guillaume Bevy is a police reporter who joined our team. He was really good. Then he left because he lost faith in your ability to lead the unit. Other people have left, too. Good, smart people. People we won't get back. Only me and this really patient patrol officer are still here. And Trant, because I'm forcing him to stay. Okay, so what does this unit do? Do? It's a major crimes unit. We clear the desk of cases so Precinct 41 doesn't look like the worst station in town. We're a crap tier now, Harry, because of you. The 41st isn't... Kim trails off, not wishing to finish the sentence. Where have you been all this time? There was a mercenary tribunal. God damn it, Harry. He shifts his weight, crosses his arms, and looks you in the eye. You told us to screw off. You said we're cramping your style. You're a detective god. Screw everything. All will burn. Detect or die. Why didn't you detect or die, then? Oh, you think it was cool, you saying that? Aesthetic somehow? You were crying when we got here, breaking things. You said we were going into the abyss. None of us wanted to see the Abyss, so we screwed off. Like you told us to. Wait, so you let me face a squad of trained killers alone just to teach me a lesson? It wasn't like that, Judith said. Screw you, Harry. We didn't know there was going to be a tribunal, did we? I said all those things. I'm not like that anymore. Yes, you're sorry. You're the sorriest cop who ever lived. Nothing has changed, Harry. I've heard this repentance stuff a million times over. Well, none of this is ringing any bells. The bells aren't ringing because you have brain damage. Trant, he turns to the blonde, this is where you come in. How bad is it? Well, he doesn't have visible tremors. He talks without slurring. He can drive a boat. He's standing, reasoning, all good signs, but complete retrograde amnesia, episodic and semantic. Rhetoric says, meaning you forgot both who you are and the definitions of money, Isola, pale, and so on. As displayed in the station call, our interactions with him and... I don't want to be a snitch, he makes air quotes, but also mine with him before, when Harry did not seem to know who I was. It's all very interesting. Interesting, John says? Yes, interesting. I have my theories, but I would like to hear Harry's thoughts first. Harry, he turns to you. What do you think happened to you, neurologically, psychologically, and, why not, socioeconomically? That. I made it all up. It might have something to do with an anomaly in the church. Oh, possibly. Wait, socioeconomically? You think I'm so poor I lost my memory? Not when you phrase it like that, but I don't think critical theory... I know everyone thinks this is far-fetched, pink academia, but still, I don't think she should be off the table here. Jean says, wait, he lost his memory because of capitalism? What? Not wait. No, not like that. I'm not talking Vredefort school here, but Harry, I asked you, what do you think what happened? What do you think happened? Either this or this or this. Something so sad happened to me that I couldn't be me anymore. It was a defense mechanism. Jean says, psychotraumatic amnesia? Trant? He turns to the special consultant. I can go for that. He's a broken man. Always has been. Who isn't? I know I am. But you know what? He turns back to you. I keep it together. Also, I know a person can't wipe their own mind. However traumatic it gets, that doesn't happen. You're lying, or insane, or both. But Detective Vicmair, she interjects, he has blanked out before. I have? Yes, a couple of times, after some of the more serious benders. She pauses, remembering. One was after the two drunks case, the other when we looked into that mural. Conceptualization says you don't remember not remembering. Beautiful. Reaction speed says, the two cases in your ledger, the unsolvable case and the New World mural, those are recent. Half-Light said, those cases were hard on you. Interesting, Trant says. So at first he dipped his toes into it, prepared. That's where he would have gotten the idea, yes. Practice, and then he used alcohol to get there, so to speak. What do you mean? Jean says. Well, here's my theory. What if this is an absolutely normal reaction to the world we're living in? What if this is not a significant anomaly at all, something to be explained, approached as a defect? Look at the sensory input here. He gestures toward the scenery. Look at the ruins, the neon. Listen to the radio, the multitudes, the people. Live here for 40 years. As a police detective, he's like a magnetic reader on the world tape. To borrow a known metaphor, Harry's been pushed flat against it. Total input. Hardwired to the free market, he nods confidently. He just needed for it to end. Okay, Trant, thank you. That's absolutely meaningless. I'm glad we brought you. Will he or will he not be able to work in the major crimes unit? Is he a Cretan now? I want to know that. He is not a Cretan, and he is able to do work, if not in his previous leadership role, then as a line detective. I'm ready to lead again. No one even mentioned that. Jean looks at you, then at Trant. I misphrased my question. It should have been, is he able to put his clothes on and use the potty, or do we need to get him on a disability pension? What now? Now nothing. Now we're just going to stand here. Really? No. Now we discuss that. He points to the water. What the hell did you do to our motor carriage? Why is it there, Harry? Who's Jacob Ears? I thought the killer would be underwater. The time had come, tequila sunset. I drove it into the ocean when I was drunk. So refreshing. He just admits it. Thank you for your honesty. Thank you for destroying 45,000 real, I guess, of police property that's coming out of everyone's payslip. It doesn't matter. He exhales to calm his breathing. Your badge, Harry. Show me your badge. I got my badge right here. Oh, he took it? Interfacing says, in a rush to demonstrate your badge, your eager fingers can't sustain a grip on the smooth plastic, and the badge slips out of your hand. Hand-eye coordination. Plus one, you're proficient in catching small objects. I did catch that one thing. Catch it. Damn it. You juggle the badge for a second, unsuccessfully, and it lands on the ground some 2 meters away. Savoir Faire says. Pain Threshold says, ouch, you strained your elbow trying to catch that stupid thing, damn it. Healing that. He found it. The patrol officer picks it up and gives it back to you. Slippery and cold. He found it, John. It's his badge. The man stares at you, unimpressed. And your gun? Rhetoric says, as if having your badge and gun are natural states, not achievements. Conceptualization says, what is it with all these material objects? I'm not going to drop this too, am I? Show him the rifle. My gun is right here. Woo, he has it. And he didn't drop it. He wipes his brow in mock relief. You're drunk like a bum, Harry. Put that thing away before you kill someone. So what? I've had a little drink. A little drink? You smell like a corpse. I'm downwind and I can barely breathe. He covers his nose. You smell like crap. You let a suspect escape, Harry. Class J something, because you were too drunk to assess her flight risk. We've read the reports, Lieutenant Kitsaragi's. We know, Judith says. That's just a small detail in a huge case you know nothing about. Sure, if it's part of your master plan. He rubs his face in frustration. Let's not even get into the other suspect who also escaped. Another detail. Or the fact that you very likely sold your gun for booze. That's peanuts. That's nothing. That's a humorous anecdote. Damage morale, ouch. Compared to the 8 people who are gunned down, the streets are literally red with blood, Harry. It was mass murder. He did everything he could, Lieutenant interrupts him. We did everything we could. The company hired unvetted mercenaries. Lieutenant Dubois got between them and the locals. He did so at considerable risk to his own life. He was shot, not once, but twice. We stopped an execution, not a negotiation. The loss of life was minimal compared to what it could have been. Yes, it was a massacre. We got wiped. Where the hell were you? Don't make this harder for yourself, Kim says in a lowered voice. Thank you for the input, Lieutenant Kitsaragi. I didn't mean to suggest you didn't handle the situation. He brushes a stray strand of hair out of his eye and coughs. You spent the week with him, on this case. What is your take? On the case? On Lieutenant Yefreda Dubois. Well, A cold gust of wind, he pulls up his collar. The drinking, the lost gun, also losing his badge, that's all true, and he's been drinking on the job. The man sighs deeply. Then there's the self-flagellation issue. He likes to apologize profusely, making it sound like he's guilty of at least first-degree murder. It's not a good communication strategy for an officer. It's worrying, especially considering his political views. Detective Dubois is, as you may know, a Mazovian socio-economist. He wants to liquidate the ruling class, which, again, for a police officer, is a little odd. Redrick says, you should yell something. That's not a good idea. Yes, let's let the big boys talk, Redrick says. And then there's the matter motor carriage in the sea and the drugs, of course, amphetamine mostly. He breathes in sharply. But despite all this, he is a great detective. One of the best I've seen, in fact. He can talk human beings into telling him everything, and he doesn't stop. And all that time I've spent with him is not one stop pursuing leads, however far-fetched and tangential. He is tireless, madly driven. Well, except that one time when he stopped to sing karaoke, which, by the way, I have to disagree with you, Mr. Vic Mayer, was a valiant effort. He really sang his heart out. Jean says, okay, he did something. Other than that one time, he has tirelessly worked on the case, and he solved it. We have a confession, a murder weapon, and the perpetrator, locked on the island right now, awaiting transportation. He's apprehended a straggler who stayed hidden for 50 years, ever since the revolution, who's probably committed other murders over those years. He pauses. Oh, and he also discovered a new species. Trant says, a new species? A colossal stick insect. It was on the island, camouflaged as the reeds. It unfolded from the reeds. I think we may be dealing with the Insulindian phasmid. He takes out the photo of the phasmid and shows it to the officers across the yard. The wind blows, flipping the glossy triangle in his hand. Don't let go of that, Kim. Perception says you hear gasps beneath the howling of the wind. As you can see, it's about 3 meters tall. In fact, we think it may be the largest land invertebrate ever discovered. Boom shakalaka! Jean says, hell is that? The man cranes his neck, still looking at the photo. Is this somehow connected to the case? Detective? He turns to you. Yes. I believe the pheromone it emits may be responsible for the killer's mental degradation. The old man was not aware of the phasmid's presence, Kim says. Exhibiting a strange, atypical dementia, he fell into a stupor after its appearance. He became near catatonic. Judith says, so it is connected? Tran says, I must say this, he points to the photo, is absolutely extraordinary. I don't even have words for it. Yes, Jean says, it really does make it hard to fire the drunk. His tired eyes follow the photo as the lieutenant puts it away. I'm actually relieved he put the photo away. I was afraid it was going to blow away or someone was going to grab it. Empathy says, this is a very, very sad man who has just seen something that's made him forget his sadness. Rhetoric says, now you make your case. Now is the time. Now or never. Okay, I started a nightclub in the church. The phasmid female. The reeds are its nest. The killer. We have a strong motive for him. I fixed the strike situation. There's a dead man on the boardwalk. I also looked into the mystery of the doomed commercial area. Confiscated drugs. Okay. The killer, Lilianovich Dross. We have a strong motive for him. Lilianovich? Special consultant raises an eyebrow. A revolutionary matronym. What? The custom started in Grad, where they have patronyms. Krasovich, Lazovich, etc. The revolutionary saw this as a chauvinist atavism, so they used matronyms, derived from the mother's name instead. The man's mother was Lillian. He's Lillian's son, Lilianovich. The custom was overturned after the revolution failed, but not before it made it to Revachol. Judith says, so it is what a soldier of the ICM would be called. Jean says, thank you, Trant. Thank you for that piece of cultural theory. He turns to you. You said you have a motive? Of course, Trant says. Excuse me, I just thought it was noteworthy. He killed him in an act of rage induced by the phasmid's semiochemicals. Possibly induced, he corrects you. But even without that, this man spent 50 years on the islands in the bay, in solitude, loathing what Revachol has become. There's plenty for prosecution to pick from in terms of motive. Also, we have a sniper's nest with a full view of the room in which the mercenary died, right on the island, and two officers on the scene that Mr. Druss confessed to. It's a clean win, Judith says. Conceptualization says, oh, it's way more than that. Fine. It's my masterpiece. They'll teach this in cop school. Masterpiece. Jean rolls his eyes. Get over yourself, Harry. I can still smell the booze on the wind. Perception says, God damn it. It is bad. Even you can smell it. Volition says, chin up. Keep focusing on the positives here. And I also fixed the strike situation. How? It seems to be ongoing. I see red banners on the gates. Kim says he didn't quite solve it. He cross-pollinated information between the company rep and Everart until the rep came to see that the Union desires war, at which point Mrs. Messier decided to... He shrugs. What? Hand clear the terminal? I masterminded a solution to an unsolvable problem. Sounds like you got played, Harry. Maybe you were off your... Bleep on Al Ghul. Hey, how do you know about Al Ghul? Doesn't matter how I know about Al Ghul. What matters is you're Everett Clare's messenger now. A Union man, as he calls it. He's a mob boss, did you know? Kim says, it's not quite like that. The move allowed us to stabilize things here. It was not bad for Martinez, and we don't owe anyone anything. Okay, a slow nod. There was also a dead man on the boardwalk. A missing person I found. Yes, yes. Fallen through a gap in the boardwalk, drunk. How did you know I found him? Judith says, the body was transported to Precinct 41, our morgue. I had Tilbrook and Mullins take care of funeral arrangements and family stuff. That was a stupid question, how do you know? You're not the only cop in the world, Harry. This all comes back to us. Still, she says quietly, good work with the missing person, detective. Authority says, it's still a point for you. No denying it. I confiscated drugs from Kuno's dad. Who's Kuno? You don't want to know, Kim says. You're right, Lieutenant. I don't. He turns to you. You snorted the drugs. I know you did. It's all right. I mean, at this point, anything is but the drink. I also looked into the mystery of the doomed commercial area. He shrugs. I don't know what a doomed commercial area is. Rue de Saint-Gilaine 10, a commercial building where all businesses go bankrupt. I looked into it. Why? That's not what you were supposed to do here. Kim says, there was a possible witness in there, and it was close to the crime scene. He was just chasing a lead and ended up advising a local shopkeeper. It was okay. Of course. Judith turns to Vic Mayer. Call it community outreach, right? Also, the phasmid was female. The Reeds... are its nest. Female? Trant says. What makes you think so? You had to see it, Kim says. It had the subdued colors of a female, and the nesting behavior too, I think. Incredible. Were there eggs in the nest? Not as far as I can see. There were other things there, though, he turns to you. It had gathered items in its nest. A helmet, a scope, and a passport. Actually, you know, this would indicate it was a male. This is far from anything in my field, Trant says, but I think such nests are called bowers. They're for attracting mates. It could have been male, actually. It must be robust if it can move a helmet with its limbs, he trails off, lost in thought. It's so fragile, I kind of wonder how it could. Savoir Faire says it could maybe roll it, like a dung beetle. I think it responds by parthenogenesis. As in cloning itself? What makes you think so? Observation. Well, then it wouldn't matter if it's male or female. The bower would just be rudimentary behavior from before the parthenogenic mutation. Logic says that makes sense, yes. Very interesting, he looks around. quickly assessing the coast. Such organisms are extremely vulnerable to disease. A single strain of bacteria could wipe out the whole species. They're probably looking at conservation efforts here. It had mandibles that looked like hair, and it was completely white on the inside. Kim says, yes, but also reed-colored, beige and brown, a little green, on the outside. After unfolding from a single stalk, it still retained parts that looked like reed tufts on its limbs. Incredible, Trant repeats, turning to Vikmer. The PR value of this is exceptional. Cop discovers new species, maybe even discovers the Insulindian phasmid. No, that's too much. Judith says, this would really help with some of the problems we've been having. Absolutely, this is great. This does not say vigilante murderers to me at all. This says science, news, human interest, he smiles. You know, it's a really good thing you have that photo. Without it, Jean shakes his head. Suggestion says, you're doing good here, perhaps only for a moment, but still. Authority says, quit while you're ahead, or no? Quit while you're ahead? Okay, maybe don't talk about the nightclub. So what do you say? Wanna take this hot stuff back? I don't want to, but you discovered a new species and solved the murder, he shrugs. So I have to. Jude? A quick nod, honestly. Honestly, she says, anything that ends this trial is okay with me. Agreed, Trant says. The public relations potential of this is too valuable to let go. Okay, Jean sighs. We have vehicles in the square, and the perpetrator needs to be taken into custody. Let's go. I have 5 skill points. Is this stuff still cooking? Yeah. Wait, I have a few questions before we go about who I am. The man looks westward impatiently, jingling his car keys in his pocket.